Thank you for tuning in to SNU Variety, SNU's first ever TV program. A program that will not only be for your entertainment, but will be educational, enlightening, and will have a touch of suspense. My name is Tammy Cox. Boy, do we have a snugger show for you tonight. SGA's very own Brad Wilson, also known as Big Joe, will be stopping by SNU Variety later on to chat about his role in SGA and unusual nicknames he has acquired while at SNU. We also have Jock Talk with Chase Buchanan. Chase will be talking with basketball legend and men's basketball coach Bobby Martin. Wide World of Humans with Ryan Evans is going to venture further into the vast talents at SNU with Jeremy Wedge Miller's amazing ability to contort his body for entertainment purposes. We will also be bringing you Jeff White's The Search. The Search is an intriguing program where hidden truth will be unveiled. Our musical guest tonight is Amanda Martindale. She is a local cable access viewer who will be gracing us with her boy howdy rowdy country knee slapping country song. Well, I don't know about you guys, but my week has gone pretty good. Nice weather, clean laundry, what more could one girl ask for? You know, the other day though, my roommate brought up an interesting question. In the Echo section of Wines and Roses, there was a wine mentioning smelly green soap. And you know what? We have yet to find the smelly green soap. So the question of the week, where is this mystery soap? Now, straight from the home office, in Hooker, Oklahoma, is the infamous top 10 list. Tonight, the top 10 weirdest names in the Bible and their interpretations.
And love is not the easy thing, the only baggage.
Number 10, Maher Shibala Hash. She was known for her incredible international breakfast platters. Number 9, ID, what Israelites swiped while entering their tents at night. Number 8, Rodnam M., a heavily tattooed basketball player that had disciplinary problems that hooked it up with Jezebel and Delilah. Number 7, O Holy Bamaha, the Hebrew version of O Holy Night. Number 6, Oz, the man who followed that yellow brick road. Number 5, Mi Zahaba, how about you? Number 4, his brothers were Bud and Wise. Number 3, Ishai, he's a tribal man who established the peace pipe. Number 2, Rapu, God bless you. And the number 1 weirdest name in the Bible, Jack. Speaking of which, watch out for Uncle Jack next month. Well, cowboys and cowgirls, there it was, your top 10. Hold on to your keisters, it's time for Jock Talk. Booyah! Chase Buchanan is spotting Bobby Martin and this week's episode of Jock Talk. Chase?
Hello, welcome to this week's edition of Jock Talk. Today I have Coach Bobby Martin, the coach of the men's SNU basketball team, on with us. Coach Martin, thanks for joining us.
You're welcome. Good to be here.
Coach, tell us a little bit about how you wanted to become a basketball coach and how you came to be here at SNU and how you became the head coach.
Well, that's kind of a long story. When I came to SNU, which was Bethany Nazarene College at the time, I attended here for 2 years. And during my time here, I was struggling between going into full-time ministry with the church or into coaching, and really it was a process of leadership through God's leadership in my life that kind of directed me into coaching. So it's been a great experience for me. I have loved almost every second of it.
When you were going to school here, did you play basketball yourself?
Yes, I did. I was on the team here in 72 through 74.
Working with some of the students over the years, since you've been coaching for many years now here, I'm sure you've gotten to meet a lot of interesting students. And could you share a couple of really interesting students that you've met over the years that you've really had the pleasure of working with?
Well, we've had a lot of neat young people go through our program. Toby Rowland, for example, would be one that just jumps out at me. He was one of my basketball players a few years ago, and I think it was his sophomore year or junior year, I found out that his goal in life was to become a sports information director or sportscaster, broadcaster, and so I pulled Toby aside and said, how would you like to become a sports information director sooner? And that process kind of took shape, and he quit playing and became our SID. And now, as you know, he's with Channel 9 and is the director, the news director or something, associate director or producer or something. But anyway, he's a neat story. You know, I played with a young man named John Miller, who is a judge in Ada right now and a great friend. And there are hundreds of stories, Chase, like that I could go through.
Stepping into this season, most would say that it was an average season. Pretty good season for you guys. How do you feel how you guys played this season? Do you feel that most of your goals were achieved that you wanted to achieve this season, or how do you feel about it?
Well, it was a real mixed season for us. We went through a stretch where we played well, and then we went through a stretch where we just didn't compete very well at all. And the ending of the season was good. We won four out of our last six, played extremely well in some of those stretches, and probably got as much out of our team as we could in the last six games of our season. That part of it's rewarding, but the 13 games prior to that was not. So as far as our goals, no, we didn't achieve some of those. Part of the goals that we did achieve would be trying to get better every night, trying to really come close to getting to be the best we could be as a basketball team, and I think we got real close to that.
Looking back on this season, if there was one game that you could pick that could stand out in your mind that really made, that could you could just pick out of all the games that you played this season, what game would that be, the most enjoyable that you were involved in?
That was probably the OCU game over there. It was their homecoming. You know, I've had my homecoming spoiled before. That's not any fun from the standpoint of doing that to them. That wasn't the enjoyable part. But all that took place to make that game come together, the last second shot by Toby Rowland, the execution of the play by different players, the inbounds pass by Hudson right where it had to be, all those things that came together for a last second shot to win a game and against a competition like Oklahoma City University was a fun game.
This last weekend, you guys were down in Lubbock, Texas for regional championships?
Sooner Athletic Conference Tournament.
Conference Tournament. Mm-hmm. And how'd you guys do down there? Give us a little report on that.
Well, we played well. We had two very good games. The John Brown game didn't play as well the first half. The second half, we came out and scored, I think it was 57 points or so, and took over the game and ended up winning by, I guess it was 8 or 9. The Wayland Baptist game was a hard-fought contest throughout. We were down 1 at halftime, got control of the game, had an 8 or 9 point lead with about 5 or 6 minutes left in the game, and missed about 5 or 6 straight free throws. And in doing that, they got back in it and pulled ahead of us, and we were never able to get back over them. So played well, extremely well. The kids worked hard, fought hard, and executed the things that we did very well.
The goals that you had this season, obviously a big goal is winning and getting as far as you can, and you were held up a little bit short this season. How do you feel learning experiences from this season can help you guys for next season?
Well, obviously we need to recruit some good players to plug some holes for us. First of all, we lose Skipper Rowland, we lose Hudson Plachy. Trent Toler came off the bench and really helped us. Brian McNutt was our backup point guard and just did an outstanding job all year in that role. And so when you lose the quality of young men that we've lost this year, there are some gaping holes that you have to fill. So there are some things we have to do. We know what we need as a coaching staff. And an example is Coach Neely's driving back from Wyoming right now as we speak. And Coach Mo was in Texas last night and is going back again on Thursday. So we're spread out in a lot of different places, going to a lot of different games right now.
Going back to the very, very beginning when you guys had your first meeting this year, you guys laid out some goals. Tell us a little bit about what those goals were about and where you guys wanted to be at this time of the year.
Anytime I go into a season, I try to be very realistic about my goals. I want them to be high. I want us to have to work to achieve goals. But I'm pretty realistic in the approach that I take on some of those things. I would have been I would not have been a very smart coach to put an undefeated season out before these kind of guys. I knew we were going to lose some games. So the kind of goals that we set this year were a little bit different. They had goals of winning the conference championship, of getting into the national tournament, you know, those types of things. My goals for this team was every day to try to get them to work harder and to get better. And I've pretty well stuck with that goal throughout. That was really one of the main focuses of my life for 6 months, is how to get these guys better and how to get them playing as well as they possibly can at conference tournament time, because I knew that would be the key to us getting into the national tournament.
At the end of the season, the goals you try to set, as you just told me a little bit ago, was getting better recruiting,
right,
and getting some players in here to fill some holes. What goals do you and your coaching staff have to find players? What kind of players are you looking for in particular?
Well, we have to find a point guard for sure. We have to sign one. That's a given. We've got one returning, but you have to have two on your squad to make sure if an injury happens or whatever, you're covered. We need another big man. We need at least probably a 3 and a 4 and another 5 to really be a great basketball team next year. Need to add some athletic ability and some shooting.
If you can achieve most of those goals this season during the off season, as a coaching staff, being able to get some of those players in here, what kind of goals will you set out for your team next year as the season starts? Will you set out the same goals that you had set for this year, or does it depend on who you recruit in here on how high you set your goals and your standards?
It depends a lot on who we sign, and then if they show up, you know, those types of things. But some goals are always constant. You know, you want to win. That's always out there. You want to win basketball games. Spiritual goals that we have for our teams are very important to us, and they're a primary concern to us. We want growth in the lives of young men. Those types of goals are always there. They will never be changing as long as I'm coaching. But the win-loss kinds of goals, they vary from year to year. You really have to evaluate your team. You have to evaluate how close they are, how quickly they'll come together. When you add new players, are you adding new starters? If you're doing that, how long is it going to take for them to learn the system and all those types of things? So there's a lot of learning curve that takes place there that you have to kind of work through. But we're really hoping to set some high goals for this next year.
Well, I think you just pointed out a really good point, something that people often forget about too in athletics, especially here at SNU. We have a strong Christian faith, and behind that athletics, we try to put our Christian faith above
right
our athletics. What kind of Christian goals do you set for your team, and what kind of a path do you want them to follow when it comes down to that?
I want my team and the individual players to be a difference maker in lives of other people around them. They need to be able to make a difference in young people, in their student body, in every area of life. Another goal that I have for every one of those young men is that they grow, no matter what level they come in at. If they come in as a wonderful Christian, that's great, but they need to grow while they're here. So those types of things are things that we stress, that we build into practices, we build into team time, we build into a lot of different factors.
Thanks, Coach Martin, for coming on the show. Please tune in next week. We should have a pretty good show. And now I'm going to send you back to SNU Variety.
Thanks, Chase. SNU Variety is very excited about this week's guest, a junior that really needs no introduction. He's tall, he's involved, and yes, ladies, he's available. It is Brad Wilson.
Yo, big bro. How's it going?
Good. Thanks for having me today.
I'm so glad that you could come on our show.
Yeah, thanks for that. I always appreciate that promo with the ladies. You know, that always.
Oh yeah. Out, well, you know, your dating life, it seems pretty scarce these days.
It's a little stagnant, but you know, hopefully with your help.
Yeah, maybe somebody will call in. Maybe somebody will make you some cookies or something.
We can only hope.
Yeah. You're not wearing any shoes, Brad.
Yeah, that's kind of a preference of mine. I don't really care for shoes much.
You can't find them in your size.
Well, that is a problem, but no, I mean, I just like to feel the grass when I walk across campus. And
one with nature, eh?
Yeah, one with nature. But actually, this will be my last day to be shoeless for a while, because I'm actually under doctor's orders to start wearing shoes. In fact, I've got a bruise, a deep bruise on my right foot, which is kind of causing a lot of problems, keeping me from walking. So I'm not allowed to go barefoot anymore. So, Doc, if you're watching, please just ignore it.
That's pretty sad.
Yeah, I know, it is kind of sad.
Yeah.
So hopefully.
What's your deep bruise from?
I don't know.
No shoes, eh?
I guess just walking barefoot too long. I don't really question the doc. Mm-hmm. I just follow orders.
Yeah, well, good idea. Do you have any other strange quirks, like? Not combing your hair, or.
That's true. I don't comb my hair much.
Really.
I guess is that a strange quirk, or is it just being a boy? I don't know.
Oh, it's just being dirty, actually.
Okay, I guess I'm filthy.
Mm-hmm.
But I have a lot of strange quirks that involve teeth.
Really?
Yeah. Anything that's soft, touching the teeth, like the idea of like a tissue touching my teeth, just absolutely just sends chills up my spine. I mean, the other day, Ryan Dobson kept joking around by putting stuff on his teeth, and it was just killing me.
Like nails on the chalkboard, huh?
Yeah, kind of that kind of same idea.
Really?
Let me think. Strange quirks. All my good brainstorming comes on the toilet. I hope that's permissible for television. But
is that where you study, or do you just take a magazine in there, or a little notebook by the toilet?
Anything that needs to be done. Sometimes I'll study for hours on the toilet. It leaves a nice imprint on your bottom.
Yeah.
But,
does your bottom ever really hurt after getting up from the toilet?
Yeah, it does sometimes, but, you know, I get a lot of good work done there. In fact, I spent about an hour brainstorming about what I was going to say on the show today on the toilet.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad that you spent all that time in the bathroom thinking about the show. I don't know what that has to say for anything. So you live, doesn't that ever bother your roommates? Well, why don't you make yourself comfortable, Brad?
That's nice. Yeah, this is first class.
Yeah, well, we try to treat people with respect.
Nice. I appreciate it. My roommates, what were you saying?
Yeah, your roommates.
Doesn't it bother them that I spend time on the toilet?
Exactly.
I don't think so. I mean, no one, they never voiced any kind of opinion. I mean,
well, if you're in the bathroom, obviously they can't be in there.
I guess so. But, you know, for boys, that's not that big of a deal.
They could just go outside or something, water the grass, whatever. Haven't you had a different roommate every year, Brad?
That's true.
Mm-hmm. Can I ask, are you just hard to get along with?
Maybe
or
so.
Just really selective, maybe?
Maybe the question is for me as much as it is my roommates, because they all seem to be deserting me. Randy actually got married, so he turned me in for a girl, which, you know, I don't blame him for that.
Mm-hmm.
Brett left me. He went to Boston.
Yeah.
And right now, I'm with Luke, and it looks like he's going to leave me as well.
Really?
So it looks like we're going to have 4 in 4 years.
Wow, congratulations. Have you ever had anything interesting happen to you over the years with these roommates?
Well, Randy and I are pretty normal, and Luke and I we don't converse a whole lot, because one thing we've kind of had to work through some situations lately, because Luke doesn't like to, he doesn't like when I ask him questions, and I'm kind of a questiony person, so, but we're getting to that point where I don't ask questions, and that way he doesn't have to answer, and...
Well, I also hear you have this really strange obsession with Cayman's Call.
Oh, I love
Cayman's.
And
if I'm right, that's all you ever listen to.
I do, and that probably bothers all my roommates as well. My most interesting roommate was Brett, though. I mean, he's just great. Mm-hmm. And anyone that knows Brett, if you've been here for a couple of years now, you probably know Brett.
Mm-hmm.
My best story about Brett actually involves a weekend when I left town. It was Wednesday afternoon, and Brett decided to go tanning. And, I'm not real familiar with tanning, and apparently Brett wasn't either, because but apparently he went for 20 minutes, and apparently
his first time ever.
This is his first time ever, and Brett wasn't exactly a dark man to begin with. He was rather light complected, and I guess that's a whole lot, is what girls tell me.
Mm-hmm.
And so he comes back, and he is beet red. just totally beet red, and I just start cracking up. Mm-hmm. Well, I leave for Kansas City on Friday, and while I come back, and I decide I want to take a nap. I get it back late Sunday night from the weekend, and I roll back my sheets, and there are just my entire... I have dark-colored sheets. They're covered with white flakes.
That's disgusting.
And I figured out that Brett was sleeping in my bed that weekend and shed every single piece of skin on his entire body.
Nice man.
It was a great...
Did you want to bust a cap on him?
No, because it was just too funny.
Yeah.
That's one thing about Brett. It was just too funny.
Now, let's talk about the real reason why you're on SNU Variety.
Okay.
And that's because you're one of the SNU Elite SGA members. What exactly is your position?
I'm the SGA business manager, which means I guess I take care of all the financial part and any kind of accounting stuff, all the budgets and stuff like
that.
Are
you good at it?
I'm getting better.
What's the end of the year, Brad?
Well, I've gotten better throughout the year. Mm-hmm. It's not my gift as far as like staying the organized part of it. I'm good with money and I'm good with numbers. But the problem with SGA is since it switches every year, it takes, you know, about half the year to really figure out what your job is and what you're supposed to be doing. Mm-hmm. So now that I've kind of gotten that in, I'm kind of in a groove now.
So we could say it's been a learning process.
It has been a learning process.
Are you running again for this position?
I am running, but I'm going to run for president this year.
Oh, really? Big man on campus. The Big Joe, we might call him.
Big Joe is true.
How's that going?
Well, campaigning's never exactly fun, but it's good. I mean, we've got a few posters up, a few signs up. Mm-hmm. And
what's your motto this year?
I don't really have one set motto. Mm-hmm. I have a few. One, for instance, is be like Charles, vote Big Joe. And referring to Charles, our famous chef here on campus down in the cafe. I've also got Jake Page knows to vote Big Joe with Jake Page's picture of $2.50 shoved up his nose. And, of course, no
Pretty
one
impressive.
Knows more than Jake Page.
Oh, that's of course.
And then, finally, I've got one with me and my brother. Mm-hmm. He and I, just picture of us, so vote Big Joe because he's Bart's older brother.
Mm-hmm. That's a seller.
I've run into a problem with this one. I kind of plan on, you know, maybe that would reach out to the freshman people that don't know me. But the problem is a lot of people wonder who Bart is.
So we're saying that your brother's not really involved as much as you are.
He's involved. It's just Bart, I mean, there's just a lot of people that don't know who he is. Like, I mean, upperclassmen don't know who Bart is.
I don't know who Bart is.
So, but you should. Because he's also a very available bachelor.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh. And,
does Bart's this run in the family?
Bart's a celebrity. He was actually a contestant on the Price is Right game show.
No way.
He was.
Are you a big Price is Right fan?
I grew up on the Price is Right, yes. Watched it since I was a child. Mm-hmm. And I'm not quite as good as Bart because he was the more dedicated watcher.
Really?
Yes, he and Mom watched it every day diligently for several summers in a row. Took notes. We went out to the show.
Took notes?
Oh, yes. Mom had everything written down on a pad.
Really?
The story is actually quite interesting because we go out there, Mom's watched it for 20-some-odd years. Uh-huh. We actually get in the show, and they call Bart's name. He's one of the first four contestants called. Mm-hmm. Mom had us coached out there, and she was real worried about me. I was the weak link of the family because I was at camp all summer, and I wasn't...
This is going to go great for your campaign, just admitting that you're the weak link.
I was the weak link of the family because I was at camp all summer, and I hadn't been watching the show. Mm-hmm. Bart and Mom watched it every day. Mom took notes, wrote down all the prices of everything. Bart, they studied it. So actually on the plane out to San Diego and L.A. and to the West Coast, Mom was quizzing me through all the prices, you know, grandfather clock this much. Well, Bart gets called down, so we're all going nuts. And Mom just freezes. She's our champion. She's been watching it for 20 years. She just freezes.
She's so excited.
Dad, he's kind of an emotional type. Uh-huh. Dad starts bawling. He starts crying. He's so excited for Bart that he just starts crying.
That's hilarious.
Sitting there thinking, wow, we got the hokiest Oklahoma family ever. We're wearing big Oklahoma t-shirts.
That's embarrassing.
And Bart gets to the front row. Uh-huh. He did remember what Mom said to make sure you go to the far left because that person has the last bid, of course. Uh-huh. Everyone knows that. And then when Bob called on him, Bart just freaked out. He froze. He just started... He didn't know exactly what to say. He turns back to my mom. My mom's frozen. My dad's crying. Mm-hmm. It's all just going crazy. The whole family, we've been waiting for this big climactic moment, and it's not going well.
But you're cool.
I was cool for the most part, because like I said, I'm the weak link, no pressure on me.
Yeah.
But the first thing they bring out, grandfather clock. Mm-hmm. Mom quizzed me on the plane. I knew that one, $1,750. $750, simple.
Is it always the same?
It's usually around in that range.
Mm-hmm.
The highest bidder when it came to Bart was like $1,300. All he had to do was bid $1,301. He's up and playing for cars.
Mm-hmm.
Bart chokes, bids $1,200. He goes up. He fails the first time. He eventually got on, played the check game, lost, but he came home with a big green smoker and a lifetime supply of eggs.
No way, a lifetime supply of eggs.
Of eggs.
That's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
So you're pretty proud of your little brother, eh?
Oh, I'm proud of him.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, back to the campaign, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
My only other slogan is I'm kind of going off my presidential run for the student body president of Lake Park Elementary when I was in sixth grade.
Oh, so your student government experience goes way back to elementary.
Well, I guess so. I didn't actually plan on that, but as I was looking back, I've just kind of been kind of there for quite a while.
Really? When did this obsession start with having power?
Well, thank you for putting it so nicely.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I guess everybody's got to have their little niche, little group to be a part of.
When did you first get involved in student council?
I guess in sixth grade.
In sixth grade.
And we gave a little speech, and in sixth grade you really don't do a whole lot.
Mm-hmm.
We tried to get recess extended a little bit. Mm-hmm.
Did you do that? You accomplish your goals?
Recess was extended by 10 minutes,
Ooh.
As it says on the. Not that I can really confess, I really did not have that much to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
But
the truth comes out now.
But I'll accept the coincidence and campaign and run with that.
Mm-hmm. Well, this will be viewing after the fact.
So we'll just keep that.
Yeah. So what are you going to do for us if you're elected president? Are you going to extend lunchtime or something?
You're coming with the tough ones. Well, I still think recess is as important as ever.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to start a new recess initiative for college students.
Really?
Yes. Not exactly sure how I'm going to go about this, but I believe recess is still important.
Would we get like swings and slides and jungle gyms?
Sure, why not?
That would be great if
I
you
think
could
it'd be
do
great.
That.
No, as president, we'll see. I think that'll be a learning process, see what we want to do.
You don't have any goals for the school or anything?
Well, I mean, I have goals, but with student government, I mean, we are primarily responsible for, like, the social events at school. You know, we don't have a whole lot of domain over better academics, stuff like that, and not that we don't push for that.
Mm-hmm.
It's just we kind of get whatever power that we're given by the school. So I guess my goals next year would be to have better parties at a less expensive cost and just build community on campus.
Would you have the same type of parties, or would you, like, there's always a twerp and there's always a heart pal? Would you incorporate anything new in there? Or would you let your delegates do that?
Well, I'm always open to doing new stuff.
Mm-hmm.
One thing I think it is important that we do keep some of our traditions, though.
Mm-hmm.
And like I'd like to keep like Yule Feast and Heart Pound, stuff like that. Maybe change them up a little bit, you know, modernize them, you know, do whatever we need to, you know. We got to change things because that's just the way nature of the beast. But we'll see.
We must evolve. You have a very unusual nickname, Brad. It's Big Joe.
Big Joe, yes.
Might I ask where that nickname came from?
It's really kind of an anticlimactic story because my name, of course, isn't Joe.
Yeah, of course.
And it was actually passed down.
Maybe we should call you Big Brad.
Maybe so. Maybe that would make more sense.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of funny how Big Joe works, because so many people call me Big Joe. That I spend about the first semester of each year with freshmen calling me Joe. You know? And a lot of times I just won't correct them, so they'll call me Joe forever. And so then when I start...
So is that why you're doing the double campaigning, vote Big Joe?
Well, Big Joe has also kind of become my alter ego as well. So it's like whenever I do something stupid or crazy or something like that, Big Joe did that, not Brad. So it's kind of like you get two in one.
Maybe you need to see a counselor about that.
Perhaps.
Yeah. Another question would be, do you have any other nicknames?
I do. Big Joe's kind of been the one that's always been around, but some people call at Camp Canicuk, I'm the Great White Shark.
Really?
I drive a boat, and they...
So they think you're a shark
in the water, they just
because
call me
you
a
drive
shark.
A boat? You're not, like, real pale and pasty, are you?
No.
Maybe you need to stick to that story. That's a much better story.
Maybe so. But all the guys at camp, there's about five or six guys that were the sharks. And since I'm the
you're
biggest...
You're the cool group, eh?
Not necessarily the cool group, but just the sharks. And since I'm the biggest one of them, I get to be the mm-hmm. great white, since it's the biggest shark. That's pretty much the story.
Yeah.
It kind of started with one of our friends was what we call sharking a girl at camp. So we'd mm-hmm. walk around and the other
I don't understand what sharking a girl is. What's that?
I don't know. Just trying to... Mm-hmm.
You don't either, eh?
Apparently not.
Yeah.
But moving in on a girl at camp, and we'd always mm-hmm. Walk behind the girl where she couldn't see us and give her the little shark symbol.
Mm-hmm.
And so we didn't really intend to be the sharks, but it just kind of became known as the sharks. Other than that guy, none of us really sharked on women, mm-hmm. but we just became known as the sharks nonetheless.
Really?
I've also had real flattering nicknames like Ogre and Giant.
Really, Ogre.
Yeah. Big Joe's been the one that's kind of stuck.
Yeah.
And like I said, there's no real reason except for Scott Schellenberger gave it to me.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of started when I got a technical foul in my high school basketball game.
Oh, so that's why you blame all the rebel things on Big Joe.
Perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
It derives down from that first time
yeah.
when I got my first tee,
mm-hmm.
which was a great time, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, not that I'm ever going to condone getting tees, technical fouls in basketball games, mm-hmm. but it sure is a crowd pleaser.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a lot of fun.
I have one final question for you. From all the Laffy Taffy viewers want to know, what kind of key does not open a door?
A monkey.
Good one. Good one. Now, Brad, we're doing one thing here at SNU Variety. We're asking all our guests to sign the board. So,
well,
I have a very special marker.
Well, I'd be flattered.
Yes, if you could sign our board. Big Joe, Brad, the Great White Shark, whichever one you feel more comfortable doing.
We'll put a couple of them up there.
Well, Brad, thanks for making the trip across campus to chat it up. Coming up next is the part of the show that I know you all have been waiting for, the wide world of humans. This week, Ryan Evan debuts Jeremy Miller for the first time ever on a cable access channel show, The Wedge.
Mr. Evans, your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to seek out strange and unique talent around Southern Nazarene University. Good luck. This tape will self-destruct in 3, 2...
Hello, and welcome to the Wide World of Humans. I am Ryan Evans. Today we have with us Jeremy Miller, and where are you from?
I'm from Irving, Texas.
All right, and what year are you?
Junior.
All right, and what will you be doing for us today?
I can take this left hand of mine, reach over, grab my pants, and perform what's called the wedge.
All right, sounds very interesting. Go ahead and get yourself ready. Amazing. I have to ask, how did you learn to do that or discover that you can do that?
Well, when I was about fifth grade, gym class, a little over-the-head stretch, my hand went a little bit farther than everybody else's, and thus the wedge was born.
That's amazing. How often do you go about performing this technique, as it might be called?
Well, I've done it probably way too often, and I've tried to cut back, try to make it a little bit less known, so it's a little bit bigger surprise the first time you see it. But I would say probably at least once a day.
Wow, it's amazing. Do you know anybody else who can do this, or is this truly a unique talent?
The wedge is my talent. Now the arm, I do know that such famous people as Jim Carrey can pull his arm around, but nobody has yet to perform the wedge.
Amazing. Well, thank you for being with me today.
No problem.
And thank you for watching. There are no words to explain what we have just seen. The only thing that might come close would be... I would again like to thank Jeremy Miller for being my guest today on The Wide World of Humans. I'm Ryan Evans, now back to SNU Variety.
Thank you, Ryan. I'm Tammy Cox, and you're watching Channel 22's SNU Variety. Now it's time to grab your kazoos and join in and welcome our musical guest, Amanda Martindale, with No One Needs to Know by Shania Twain.
Am I dreaming or stupid? I think I've been hit by Cupid, but no one needs to know right now. I met a tall, dark, and handsome man. Now I've been busy making big plans, but no one needs to know right now. I got my heart set, my feet wet, and he don't even know yet, but no one needs to know right now. I'll tell him someday, some way, somehow. Oh, but I'm gonna keep it secret for now. Want the bells to ring, the choir to sing, the white dress, the cake, the guest, the car, the whole darn thing, and no one needs to know right now. I'll tell him someday, some way, somehow. Oh, but I'm gonna keep it a secret for now. I want a little girl, a little boy, a little Benji we call Leroy. No one needs to know right now. And I'm not lonely anymore, I'm not. And we both know only, only he can make it right.
Thank you, Amanda. I know I'm not the only one that can say we look forward to seeing you on CMT one day. Next up, for your viewing bliss and joy, Jeff White's The Search.
Some men search for gold, others search for fame. Me, I crave not these things, for I seek out the truth. You're watching The Search. Hi, I'm Jeff White, and today I'm going to discover the hidden areas around campus. Do you want to state your name and what you do?
J. Michael Crabtree, and I'm assistant to the president for endowment development and planned giving.
What can you tell us about the room we're about to go into?
Well, I believe this served a number of purposes back in the 40s, student council offices. Prior to that, I think this room housed our library.
Why was it stopped using? Why don't they use it anymore?
Well, it's, the space was just too small, and back in the, I believe it was the mid-60s, they built our T. Williams Library, but primarily just it's extremely limited space.
Do they have any plans to renovate it?
You need to talk to the comptroller and the vice president of finances for that.
All right, we'll do that. Well, we're going to head on up to the clock tower. Take a look inside. I'm just kidding. They wouldn't let us in. Let's see what else we can find.
Howard Culbertson. I teach missions here at SNU.
Okay. And what can you tell us about this room right here?
Well, it holds a couple of things. One, there's a stairway that goes on up to the observatory on top of the science hall. But inside the building is used to be the amateur radio station, ham radio station, that a few years ago there were some students and a professor very much involved in ham radio. And on the roof there's a big tall antenna that is part of that radio station and still serves as a repeater for amateur radio operators in the area. They still use it. There's not any students that I know of that are currently amateur radio operators, but the equipment's here and it still operates, and it still, you know, they bounce signals off of it and talk back and forth.
Well, the club is really active. They operate it from here. This is obviously a pretty old computer, but they used early on. So this is part of it here. And then the actual equipment is this little box right here. That's it. And it's a relay station. Signals will come into here. They'll be picked up and amplified and then retransmitted. They come in on one frequency, be amplified, and retransmitted on the second frequency. So a little 5-watt signal, which is not much, a little 5-watt signal would reach all the Oklahoma City area and beyond. Because it's picked up on the antenna, brought down here, powered up to about 100 watts or more, and then retransmitted. So that's it.
That's it. join me next week when I uncover more mysteries on The Search.
Thanks, Jeff. Well, cowboys and gals, thanks for tuning in to SNU Variety. Next time, Owen has guest Dr. Doug Samples and musical guest Troy Della Rosa. We'll be leaving you tonight with Strangers with Candy. I'm Tammy Cox asking you, do you know where your roommate is? Have a McHappy night.
Who really knows more about their ginger counterpart? Ladies first in the battle of the sexes. Today on Strangers with Candy.
My name is Cindy Alba, and I am a freshman.
Angie Mills, and I'm a freshman.
Joni Weiss, I'm a junior.
I am Kristen St. John, and I'm a senior.
Lisa Gerber, and I'm a sophomore.
My name is Zena Zander, and I'm a sophomore with junior credits.
Do you know a lot about guys?
A lot about guys.
That was my question. Do you know a lot about guys?
No.
Do you know a lot about guys?
Enough, I guess. I don't know.
Do you know what team Cal Ripken Jr. played for?
That's baseball, right? He's a baseball player?
Yeah.
What team? I heard you laugh. What team was... Mouth it to me. The Yankees.
No. In that area of the country, though.
Isn't there another New York baseball team?
Not New York. In Maryland.
Orioles.
All right, there you go. You know who the great Joe DiMaggio played for?
New York.
What team?
Mets?
The other one.
No, I don't know. I'm horrible at the Yankees.
There you go. Do you know what team the great Kareem Abdul-Jabbar played for?
No, I can't say that I do.
Really?
Not really.
You don't even know what city?
No.
What if I told you it was Los Angeles?
The Lakers?
Right. Who drove NASCAR number 3?
Gordon? Earnhardt? Dale Earnhardt?
With a little help from the audience, huh?
Whatever. Dale Earnhardt.
What are the two regular types of screwdrivers?
The Phillips, right? Is that one?
Yeah.
And the,
something is not round. It's, piece of paper is?
Flathead screwdriver.
There you go. Do you know what the two regular kinds of screwdrivers are?
Flathead and Phillips.
Yeah. See, these are easy questions. Do you know what the two regular types of screwdrivers are?
Yeah, I think so. A Phillips and... That's it. I don't know.
If something is not round, it might be...
Flat. So, a flathead?
Oh. Yes, that's right. Do you know, in football... How many points a safety is worth?
3.
No.
A safety. I love football, but I don't know. 1. 2.
Ah.
2.
There you go.
2.
In football, how many points is a safety worth?
7.
Lower.
4.
Lower.
1.
Higher.
2.
There you go. There you go. And the subject of football, do you know how many points a safety is worth?
No.
You don't?
No.
You want to just guess?
15.
Lower.
7.
Lower.
1.
Higher.
3.
Lower.
2.
There you go.
All right. 2 points on a safety.
2 points on a safety, yes. Try one just a little bit harder.
Okay.
What kind of a saw would you put on a table?
A table saw?
Incredible. Amazing. Here you go. Here is your candy.
Thank you.
And thank you for being on Strangers with Candy.
No problem.
Here's a very hard question. What kind of a saw would you put on a table?
Would you put on a table?
Yes. A saw that goes on a table.
A table saw.
There you go. Here you go. Yay. And thank you for being on Strangers with Candy. One last question. And this one is a tough. It's very tough. Can you name three cars that start with P?
Pontiac, Pinto, Porsche, Plymouth, Pathfinder. That's all I know. I don't know.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Actually, those all start with gas, but that's okay. Everybody is a winner.
Oh.
So here's your candy. So here you go. Here you go. The choices.
I don't know what I like best. I think I'll
Okay. Thank you for being on Strangers with Candy.
No, thank you.